blessings. You will enjoy. If you get into the culture of learning your hymns top ahead, there is a blessing unknown. I'm knowing your hymns by head. Because oftentimes we think God comes to speak to us in this fashion, as we are seated here. But sometimes when we are seated here in this session and worshiping, and sometimes you sit there and you say, I don't think this message is for me. There is a reason why heaven made a provision for that message for that day. That provision may not be for that day. It may be for 10 years later. But it is necessary for you to hear the message that day. And it will make sense 10 years later. So there is never a time when God's word is preached that it leaves you unchanged as a person. So when you learn your hymns and you know them off by heart, in your trouble, you afford heaven's provision, the opportunity to go into the archives of your mind and pull a text through a song which you need for that time. So we must get into the culture of knowing our hymns. Sometimes it can be a life-saving exercise. By the way, for this, I am yet to read my Bible and find a true servant of God who was not at some point suicidal. Is not at some point suicidal. All of them, including the disciples. It is the prophet who hides in a cave. And God says, what are you doing? And he says, only I am. All of them have been killed. All the prophets of God have been killed. And God says to me, you are not the only one who remains. I have many servants. Moses was also suicidal because he says, God says to him, these people are not listening, so I'm going to kill them all. Then Moses says, you'd rather blot my name out of the book of life before killing them. I want to close this session with a music, a theme that I think has cut across all our services throughout this conference, and the song says, why should I feel discouraged, and why should the shadows come, why should my heart be thank you. makes the same argument that the songwriter makes. And Matthew says, for if he clothes the lilies of the field, is your life not worth more than they? Consider the birds of the air. They do not sow, nor do they reap, but your heavenly Father provides for them. Then he says, whom amongst you can add an ounce of life, a minute to their life by worry? As you come to listen to the message now, what I'm simply trying to say this is there's power in music. Oftentimes we are misunderstood and misconstrued. Sometimes when you raise your hands, the next person seated next to you, who's oblivious of your situation, does not understand why your hands are raised. But raise them anyway. Raise them anyway. Sometimes we shout and our actions can be misconstrued. But we are not mad. Because, you see, our experiences shape our worship. And one day, when you've had your taste, your fair share of a taste in life, the way you approach worship will change. So, be mindful of the person next to you. I appreciate that sometimes it can be an irritant, but bear with them, because they may be going through something that you would possibly never understand. I'm falling in love with this song. La pesho kona go.
I greet you this evening in the name of Jesus the Christ. Amen. Grace and peace unto you all this evening in the name of Jesus, who restores, rehabilitates, and recycles our broken characters. Jesus. Amen. Perhaps it is only befitting for me to begin from this morning's discourse for the benefit of those who are not here this morning. The pastor reads Luke chapter 5, and the Bible says that when the disciples could not catch any fish the whole night, Jesus then says to them, cast your net unto the right hand, cast your net one more time. But my interest then becomes verse 10, when Jesus says to them, from now on, you will not catch fish, but you will catch men. In other words, Jesus says to them, you will now transition from being fishermen into being fishers of men. Now, Jesus here presents to us what I'd like to call the paradox of discipleship. Because what the disciples were doing was that they were taking fish out of the ocean. Now, Pastor Kumeni, when you read in Greek, the word that Christ uses that says to save, it is the word zokreo, which means to save. In other words, the implication of the word suggests that you will no longer harm lives, but you will save lives. Now, the act of catching fish is an act of harming. Because when you remove fish outside the ocean, they can no longer survive. Therefore, you have killed them. But when you take men out of the darkness into the marvelous light, you now transition from death to life. So Jesus is essentially saying to them, you will no longer transition from life to death, but you will transition from death to life. Can I say to you, the call of discipleship is that when we preach the gospel, we take and move lives from death into life. We move people from darkness into the marvelous light. So when Jesus calls us, he calls us into the ministry so that we do not harm lives, but so that we bring light into lives of people. And so the question then remains, how many of us through our ministries have harmed lives? How many of us have been the cause of people leaving the church of God? And then verse 11 then says, after Jesus says these things to them, they heed to the call of what he said, and they left everything that they had, and they followed him. Now here's one thing you need to understand, is that for the disciples, fishing was a career. It was everything to them. But when the master calls, they tend to heed to his call, and they leave all that they were doing, and they follow him. Now, this is what it seems to suggest, that they put their appetite aside for the greater calling that the Messiah calls them into. Can I say to you, it is very dangerous to put your stomach first and leave what the Lord has called you into. And so many of us sacrifice what God has called us into to feed our stomachs. And so the disciples decide to heed to the call of what Jesus has called them into. And they follow him into the journey of Christianity. But as they journey, David then writes, this was the midday service. He says, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. Thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Then verse 5 says, you prepare a table in the presence of my enemies. Now here's my point of interest here, is that is the sequence in which these events happen. Before they can get to the table, they must first pass through the valley. In other words, for you to get to the table, you must first get through the valley. I'm simply here to say to you this evening, that when you go through the valley, do not look near to you, but look further, for there is a table that is being prepared for you. But this evening's discourse, I'm not going to take much of your time, comes to us from the book of Romans chapter 8. Romans chapter 8. I'm going to read 4 verses and then we'll depart in the name of Jesus. Romans chapter 8. We'll begin our discourse from verse 24 and we'll conclude with verse 28. Romans chapter 8. And the Bible says, "For in hope we have been saved. But hope that is seen is not hope. Who hopes for what he already sees? But if we hope for what we do not see, through perseverance we eagerly await for it." Verse 26. "Now in the same spirit, in the same way, the Spirit also helps us in our weakness. For we do not know what to pray for as we should. But the Spirit intercedes for us with groanings too deep for words. And he who searches the hearts knows what the mind of the Spirit is, because he intercedes for the saints according to the will of God." In verse 28, our concluding text, "And we know that all things work together for good to those who love the Lord and are called according to his purpose." May the good Lord add a blessing to the reading of his word in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Let's pray together. Gracious, kind, and heavenly Father, your word has been read. We ask, O dear Master, that you may come down and tabernacle upon us, and you also speak to us in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
This evening I want to speak from the theme, hope, the gift of unrest. Hope, the gift of disquiet. Now hope, when it arrives, it does not allow for you to rest. I don't know where I get that one. So in other words, this is what hope does. When you find yourself in a hopeless situation, hope comes and it occupies that space and it gives you hope to continue going. Let me make this example. When you pray, and you pray for something, right? The distance between your prayer and the answer to your prayer is hope. Because when you pray for something and God has not yet answered, what occupies that space is hope. But when the answer to your prayer arrives, hope then departs. So hope is what gives us unrest. Hope is what comes when we are hopeless. Now hope, picture with me, one scholar says it is like two twins, right? Two twins, which is hope and an answer to a prayer. It is like two twin brothers who love each other, but they cannot reside together. When the other one arrives, the other one departs. So when you hope, when you pray for something, and the answer to your prayer has not yet come, hope occupies that space. And when the answer to your prayer comes, hope then departs. That is hope. But here's what hope does. Hope, when it arrives, it does not allow you to be comfortable in what you have. It does not allow you to be comfortable. But hope helps you to look at what is beyond. In other words, when you hope, you look beyond and further than what you see. In other words, when you hope, it is as though you have tasted that which has not yet become, but it occupies the space to keep you going in the present. I don't know whether you're walking with me, man. So this is what I'm saying. That when you find yourself in a certain situation and you do not know what to do, it is hope that comes and occupies that space. But when the answer to what you're looking for arrives, hope then departs. But here's the thing, hope does not operate like a pacifier. You know what a pacifier is? For those of us who don't know it, what you give to a child when you want to pacify them, for them not to want milk that they drink. Right? So that is what hope does. Hope does not allow you to be pacified. But hope keeps you going in the present whilst helping you to look forward to that which is coming. In other words, picture with me a small child who is used to be breastfed each and every day. Then one day the parents decide that you no longer breastfeed the child. We will give them a pacifier. But because the child is used to being breastfed, the child then cries and weeps because they know the taste of being breastfed. And they cry and they say, I don't want this pacifier because this is not the main thing. This is not the real thing, but I want the real thing. And the child cries because the pacifier cannot pacify the child enough to occupy what the breastfeeding can do. That is what hope does to us. It does not allow the current situations that we go through to give us what we need. It does not allow our current situations to satisfy us. But hope keeps us looking forward to that which is coming, even though it has not yet become apparent. That is hope. And so Paul says, for we hope for what is not already seen, because hope is not seen. For who hopes for what they have already seen? Now here's the thing. When you read The Theology of Hope by Jürgen Moltmann, one of the statements he writes, he says, hope and anxiety. I want to quote this statement for you. He says anxiety and hope have one thing in common, in that for anxiety, we anticipate possible danger. But hope, we anticipate possible deliverance. In other words, when you are hopeful, you do not anticipate danger, but you anticipate possible deliverance. So this is why he says, this is what saves us. Because then Paul then says to Titus, for we know and have this blessed hope in the coming of the Lord our Savior Jesus. Though Jesus has not yet come, but the hope of him coming is what keeps us going in the present, looking forward to what he has and looking forward to what is already coming. So in other words, this is to say, whilst we look forward to that which is coming and it has not yet already become apparent, hope occupies that space and it keeps us going, looking forward to that which is coming. I don't know whether you get this one. So he says, this is hope, the hope that we have. So he says, we do not hope for that which we can see. Because hope is not something that is tangible. It's not something that we can see. Because if you can see it, it is not hope. And if it is something that you can reach, then it can never be hope. Because hope is never reachable. When you get to what you are hoping for, then hope departs. The next thing that I want us to talk about, Paul then says, for we eagerly await for it in perseverance. Then he says in verse 26, likewise, the Spirit intercedes for us when we pray, for we do not know what we should pray for as we should, but the Spirit helps us to pray because he knows the mind of the Spirit. Therefore, he intercedes for us. You might not understand this text. Maybe I need to explain it to you using Luke chapter 15. The Bible says, when the boy finds himself in the mud, and then the Bible says, the boy, when he's in the pigsty and he finds himself there, he rehearses a prayer. And as he rehearses a prayer, he says, this is what I'm going to say to the Father. And then he says, Father, I have sinned against you and against heaven. Accept me as a servant, not as a son. Take note. And then the Bible says, when he journeys back home and he gets back home, the Bible says the Father does not accept him back as a servant, but the Father accepts him as a son. Yeah. This is to say, he prayed to become a servant, but God accepts him as a son. This is to say, when you pray your prayer, Sometimes your prayer is far inferior to the will of God.
Yes,
and God has prepared something that is far ahead than what you can ever expect. Therefore, he prays to become a servant, but the Father accepts him as a son. And so he says, likewise, we do not know what we should pray for.
Yes,
but when we pray, the Spirit intercedes on our behalf. Because he knows and he understands what the Spirit is. So I'm simply saying to you that when you pray, at times the Holy Spirit changes your prayer and he aligns your prayer with the divine will so that your prayer is acceptable to the divine. And therefore you get more than you had expected when you pray. Because the Spirit intercedes for us and he knows the will of God. And so he says, likewise, we do not know what to pray for or how we should even pray. But the Spirit intercedes for us with groanings. And then he says, as I conclude, now all things work together for good to those who love the Lord and are called according to his purpose. Now the English word all is an all-inclusive word. When it says all, it is a conglomeration of both the bad and the good.
Yeah.
Now this presents to us upon what we call the concept of synergy.
Okay.
What is synergy? It is a conglomeration of two or more substances that come together, whether good or bad, for the greater good. In other words, take for instance, when you drink and you go to a doctor, and the doctor gives you medication. Now we understand that medication has side effects, but the side effects in the medication come together and they work together for your own good. Now Paul says, now all things in the life of a Christian, whether good or whether bad, come together and they work for good. I'm simply saying to you, whether the good or the bad in your life, they come together in what we call synergy and they work together for good. I'm simply here to say, whether you go through the bad, whether you go through the good, child of God, when you are called according to his purpose, all things will work together for good. I'm simply here to say, I don't know what you're going through. I don't know what you're facing in life. But those things will come together because they work for good. All things work together for good. Then he says, when he concludes in verse 35, he says, nothing. Or he says, he asks a question. What shall separate us from the love of the Father? Whether be the angels, be the demons, be the darkness, be the light, be anything, what shall separate us from the love of the Father? Then he says, nothing, and I mean nothing, can separate us from the love of the Father. Then he says, nay, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. This is to say that when we are with Jesus, we are more than conquerors. Now for you to understand this text, you have to understand the context of this text. Because when Paul writes this text, he finds himself in Rome. And the Romans had what we call a hierarchy. And the hierarchy of the Romans simply suggested that at the bottom of the hierarchy were the barbarians. On top of the barbarians were the Jews. On top of the Jews were the women of Rome. And on top of the women of Rome were the men of Rome. On top of the men of Rome were the soldiers. And on top of the soldiers were the conquerors, those who went to war and they conquered. But he says, when we are with Jesus, we are on top of the conquerors. I don't know what you're facing, but when we are with Jesus, we have conquered everything because we are on top of the world. I don't know what you're facing today, but I'm simply saying to you, nothing can separate us from the love of God. Be it the good, be it the bad. Beat the angels, beat the demons, beat the light, beat the darkness. And nothing can separate us from the good. And then he says, for hope is what has saved us. I'm simply saying to you that because we have tasted that which is yet to come, we are not satisfied by the glories of this world. We are not satisfied by the victories of this world. But we are looking forward for a world that is to come. The Bible says, when Jesus shall come, there shall neither be sorrow, no more pain, no more dying, no more nothing that is painful to harm us. But we are looking forward to that world. Because we have tasted that which is to come, we are not pacified by that which we have on earth. I'm simply here to say, through this hope, we have been saved. Please understand this with me. That hope, this hope that we have, this hope that we have, does not allow us to find satisfaction in the joys of this world. You see, the problem with many of us is that we only look forward to the coming of Jesus when things are going well. Sermons of the second coming of Jesus, I've noticed, are only preached in funerals. But when we have celebrations, we never preach about the second coming of Jesus. But I'm simply here to say, because of this hope that we have, the hope that has given us a taste of that which is to come, we will not be pacified by the glories of this world. I want to conclude on this note. There's a very famous preacher who tells a story. It's a very famous sermon. At the conclusion of the sermon, he says he's from a rural area. He says he moved from the rural areas into the cities. When he gets to a certain city, he realized that the city was better than the rural area. Because there were lights, there were electricity, there was tar, there was everything. But then when he gets to that city, he also realizes that there's another city that is better than that city. Yeah. And then he goes to that city and he finds out that there's a city that is far better than that city. But then here's the thing, the preacher had to come back to his very own rural area. In other words, that which he had seen had given him hope of that which is good in life. And therefore he was no longer satisfied with the state of the rural area which he was from. So one day I came back from school. I think I'm around about grade 8 or 9. I think you might remember. So we went to a friend of ours. We were playing FIFA there. So this was around the time FIFA had just been released. And I had a PS3 at the time. And so a friend of mine had a PS4. And so we went to play the PS4. And when I played the PS4, I enjoyed it so much, man. I enjoyed it so much. So much that when I had to go back home, my mother got me a FIFA. I was not satisfied because I tasted the PS4. I was not satisfied. This is the hope that I'm talking about. That when you have tasted eternity, you will no longer be satisfied by the joys of this world. This is why when Abraham Heschel writes, he says, when we experience the Sabbath, we experience eternity in time. Because eternity visits us in 24 hours. This is to say, the Sabbath is but an atmosphere. The Sabbath, we do not occupy space, but we occupy time. Therefore, we do not enjoy the 24 hours in which eternity visits us. You will not enjoy eternity to come. But when you have tasted eternity, you no longer want the Sabbath to depart. I'm simply saying to you, enjoy the Sabbath day, because the Sabbath presents to us the eternity that is to come. Do not be satisfied by the joys and the glories of this world, because of the joys that are coming, because of what we have tasted, because of what is to come. I'm simply here to say, man, we have tasted better. Do not be satisfied by what the world is giving you. I don't care whether you're graduating. I don't care whether you're getting married. But that cannot compare to the glory that is to come. May God be with you all, man. As the Sabbath, eternity visits us. And when eternity visits us, enjoy eternity, because it gives us a taste of the world to come. Amen. Therefore, I close with verse 18. Verse 18 says, For I know that, say it, the sufferings of this world cannot be compared with the glory that is to come. May the good Lord be with you all in Jesus' name. Amen. The Lord is good.
All the time.
Hi, the Lord is good. We're going to have two songs now. One from our
piano, and the second song will come from the Stasa Choir Quartet.
Okay.
It is the same Abraham Heschel.
Yeah. The rabbi himself.
Who tells an account of the Jews when they were being persecuted by Hitler. And he tells an account of one rabbi who had been hiding in the caves. And this rabbi who was hiding in the cave, we knew it was the Sabbath. He says it was an inexplainable feeling. But we always knew when it was the Sabbath. Then he closes the thought by saying, the spirit of the Sabbath is such that it changes the atmosphere around you. You may be oblivious to the going of the days, but you will be conscious of the Sabbath when it arrives.
My hunger with from the world.
Should it happen that we find ourselves moving contrary to your will, we ask this evening that, Lord, dispatch the provision of heaven to come and steer us into the right direction. We thank you for the privilege of your summer, wherein we experience the corridors of heaven. We are learning for the day when our faith shall be inside. where we have failed to lovingly solicit forgiveness. Whether it be in thought, in actions, may you prepare room for each and every one of us here. And should it happen, Lord, when this conference comes to an end, that life does not afford us the privilege of meeting this side of heaven, may we convocate all the classes and sing the song of Moses and the Lamb. The lyrics are not known today, but our experiences will be the lyrics of that song. Thank you for being a loving Father. And as we enjoy the Sabbath, come with us, Lord. And may we experience you fully. And when we leave this conference, let it be evident in the way we lead our lives that surely we have been to the foot of the cross.